let me first start with a compliment to Ukraine and Ukrainian people. First, to overcome the dull and corrupt previous regime, to survive the attempts to destabilize the country, the annexation of Crimea, and the war in parts of Donbas, and to keep faith in the future despite of thousands of killed people, tens of thousands wounded, and millions of refugees. This deserves really full admiration from outside, and this is my starting point. As a practical person, I have three priorities. What is to do? The first priority, of course, is to stop the fighting, to stop the armed conflict. The second is to repair the economic damage, which is huge. The third point is to start the reconciliation process internally and externally. On stop of the armed conflict, I think needs to do. It's not, by far not perfect. It's a shaky situation now, but it's the best solution we just have. So let's use it. And I think what the international community, especially Angela Merkel and François Hollande and the European institutions are doing, should be supported from all sides. Of course, it takes two to tango, is the famous Sprichwort sentence, but I think it is important from our side to keep contact, to keep talks running. Second point is to repair the economic damage. This is, as an economist, this is a very important task. And you should not underestimate the problems and the real difficulties. If you look to the economic data of Ukraine last year, -7%, this year probably -5%. The damage of the war, more than $10 billion US dollar. If you look to the loss of Ukrainian exports to the Russian and the Eurasian market, more than 1/3. The exports to the European Union, +12%, but this is nothing compared with the loss on the other side. Of course, there is international assistance, $40 billion so far committed. I hope the money will really come. But it should be linked to internal reforms, and this is not quite easy. Let me use one example. If you look back 25 years ago, Poland and Ukraine had de facto the same starting point. The average per capita income in Poland was a little bit above 4,000 US dollar, in Ukraine a little bit less than 4,000 US dollar. Today it is 18,500 US dollar in Poland and 6,000 in Ukraine. The average at that time was, compared with the average of the EU, Poland had around 30%. Ukraine around 26%. Now Poland is up to 70%, and Ukraine is down to 23%. And the starting point, by the way, as an economist, for Poland was worse than for Ukraine. Poland had at that time, 25 years ago, a foreign debt of close to $50 billion. Ukraine had 3.5 billion foreign debt. It looked to be to the soil, to the climate, this famous red earth, to the huge scale agriculture and agriculture business in Ukraine, the small scale farmers in Poland, look to the industrial base, look to the minerals. So I think the reality, what caused the gap between Poland today and Ukraine today, this is something we should have in mind. So I think the most important task for the time being is to learn the lesson. Poland had, by the way, it was not the shock therapy. By the way, the shock therapy in the beginning was it costed an enormous social cost that did not work in the beginning. Then, a more pragmatic and a more gradual move in the Polish reform process helped. And then the slow recovery after 1993 started. The real difference was civil society, rule of law, new faces, and a European aspiration. This is the, and of course, not the oligarch structure which damaged Ukraine so much. So if you want to start the real process, economy is the basis for everything. The spiritual and economic basis is necessary. If you want to improve the situation in Ukraine, start immediately with the de-oligarchization, kill the oligarchs, I mean not physically, but so to say in the frameworks, take away the illegal wealth, try to have a good taxation, to install the rule of law, etc. I think this is something which is of utmost importance. And the third point, even more difficult and more challenging, is the reconciliation. Reconciliation is very difficult. If you have such a situation, a warlike situation, de facto it's still war, then it is not easy to build bridges, because you have internally, you have a lot of voices who are against reconciliation. You have a lot of nationalistic tendencies, because if there's pressure from outside, a lot of people are looking for the strong guy, for the starken Mann, the strong leader who can solve everything with his sword, cutting the Gordian knot, etc. It will not work. There is no military solution possible. Not for the Russians, not for the separatists, not for Ukraine. The only thing is reconciliation, talks, and building bridges, which is not easy, because again, it takes two. You have the same language on both sides. And to integrate these people is not easy. Because they are also they feel themselves inserted pressure from outside and inside, etc. So what is it all about in Ukraine today, from my point of view, is to find a new contemporary identity. This is something, not the old way of the nation states, the old nationalistic tendencies, to find a new contemporary identity, especially for the young generation. This is not easy. This is not easy, this challenge. In my opinion, Ukraine is a great country, not only in the resources, but in mentality, in the cultural richness, in diversity. You have so many ethnic groups in Ukraine. This is fantastic. You are de facto in panopticon in itself. This is a kind of a variety which only a few countries in the world have. This is a real source, a rich source for you. You have Ukrainians, you have Russians, Belarus, Moldovans, Poles, you have even some German speaking people, you have Tatars, you have Romanians, you have Hungarians, you have Jews. This is a great source for the future development, but it requires the tolerance and the need to accept ambiguities, to accept ambivalences, to accept diversity. And this is not easy, because if there's pressure from outside, especially military pressure, there is a tendency to unify, to pull together all your strength, etc. This is the contrary of what is needed for reconciliation. And by the way, Ukraine is an open country, a flat country, with no national borders. You have not the Himalaya on one side, the seaside, maritime is there. But normally, Ukraine is an open, flat country, huge country, open for pressure, not very much protected, sensitive to the influence of neighbors. Looking to the past of Ukraine, there were always Timothy Snyder, bloodlands. You have a land of conflicts, the most bloody conflicts and battles were made and were located here in Ukraine and also in Belarus. So that's the only way for your new identity, new contemporary identity, to see Ukraine as a bridge to north, east, south, and to the west. This is also not easy, because it requires an openness in mind, a new idea. I think the Maidan spirit had something like that. So the often the mentioning of European values, this was exactly that. It reminds me a little bit of the old Austro-Hungarian Empire. It was also a kind of a multicultural, very diverse empire, although with a very, very weak political class, ruling class. And this, by the way, led with other with other external influences to World War I. But the idea to have such a variety of languages, of cultures, of smells, of music, this is fantastic. literature, this is fantastic. So, my last remark is, this is the most difficult point. Sooner or later, you will have to talk to the separatists, to those who are your enemies today. It's like a Christian lesson. Talk to your, love your enemy, not only talk, love your enemy. There is a need to stay in contact. I moderated a few weeks ago, I think one month ago, in Vienna, a discussion between Yushchenko, the former president of Ukraine, Václav Klaus, the former president of Czech Republic, and William de Klerk, the South African president. Václav Klaus said, everything which Putin is doing is perfect, wonderful. He is completely right. Okay, Yushchenko, exactly the opposite. We will never talk to these criminals, etc. We have to guarantee the unity and stability of our country. Very understandable. And then William de Klerk, the old man, said, look, I'm far away, living thousands of kilometers in South Africa. I have no idea about the real problems in your region. But sooner or later, you have to talk to these people. If I wouldn't have talked to Nelson Mandela, and at that time he was in prison, I got him out of prison just to talk to him. If I wouldn't have talked to Nelson Mandela at that time, it was very crucial, very not so easy, because the ANC at that time was not a very peaceful organization, by the way, to be honest. And Nelson Mandela had also his personal record. Today it's now a little bit glorified and mystified. I talked to him. If I would not have talked to Nelson Mandela, South Africa would look today like Syria today, a ruined landscape. So please, please, talk to them. Set specific conditions. The separatists must accept, should accept unity of Ukraine. No doubt about it. They should accept elections under Ukrainian rule. No doubt about it. But start now with these conditions. And then, of course, with the pressure also from the European Union, from America, from the Western part, hopefully it will work. So this is my brief remark at the beginning. Thank you for inviting me. And sorry that I came a little bit too late and missing my friend Jose Casanova, but I have his speech with me. I will read it. Thank you.
Thank you.